Hey everybody, this is Rustin with Metalholic Magazine and The Examiner, and with us today, Chris Jericho. Of course, you know him as the WWE wrestler from Dancing with the Stars, actor, Golden God Revolver Awards MC, but of course, for us, the voice of Fozzie. How you doing, brother?
Good, man. How's it going?
Absolutely wonderful. I have to tell you straight out the gate, I am actually, your new album, Sin and Bone, is just kicking my ass. I love that thing.
Oh, great. I'm glad. That's always the idea. Open up the album, open up the CD, put on the MP3, and just have your ass kicked. Mission accomplished.
Absolutely. Now, you've always wanted to be both a singer and a wrestler. How in the hell did you make two dreams come true when most people can't kickstart one?
I don't know. It's weird. I started playing in bands when I was 12 years old, and always been, you know, obsessed with music, playing music, all things music. And then same thing with wrestling. And I just decided that I wanted to do both. Wrestling kind of took off first, and then kind of just continued on from there. But even when I started to wrestle, I was always writing demos and writing songs, and started Fozzie in 1999 and kind of started working on that too. So it has been an interesting career choice, so to speak, and been very fortunate to make them both come true.
Now, this is your guys, Sin and Bone is your guys' fifth album, the third one to contain all original material, your first album for Century Media, but honestly, this really feels like the first real Fozzie album. It's like you guys were sort of getting your feet wet before, coming up with some great stuff, but this really feels like a foundation album to launch Fozzie.
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, I think I might have said that about our last record, Chasing the Grail. That's kind of when we kind of reconfigured what we were doing with Fozzie and where we wanted to take the band, and also the style of music. I mean, Chasing the Grail is where we first realized all we do best is very heavy riffs and very melodic, hooky choruses, and not a lot of people are doing that or doing that style of songs. And that's when it came time for Sin and Bones. We wanted to kind of continue going in the direction that we started with Chasing the Grail, and got so much momentum from the Grail tour. We toured for 18 months and did 16 countries and played so many great shows with so many great bands. And then Century Media came calling, and it was just all of this momentum was building up to take it to the next level. So we knew that we had a real chance to go somewhere bigger with Fozzie, and that's why we put all of our efforts into writing Sin and Bones. Like I said, taking away the songwriting style that we do with Grail to the next level.
And the first single off the album, Sandpaper, is obviously you got M. Shadows from Avenged Sevenfold on it. How did that come about? Because it does have sort of that Avenged Sevenfold feel to it, but you and Rich wrote the song, and it really melds well with the other songs on the album.
Yeah, I mean, that was just something where Shadows and I are very good friends. We became really, really close over the last couple of years. And when we were doing Sandpaper, there was part of the beginning, Cat Scratch and Whiplash, which I'm black, that I was laying it down, and it wasn't really, like, it was okay. I wasn't really capturing the vibe that I wanted to capture, which happens sometimes. And Rich and I both sing in the band once in a while. So I was like, Rich, why don't you just sing this part? He sang it well in the demo. And I thought, listen, maybe let me give Matt a call and see if he'd be interested. And he called back right away, and I sent him the demo, and he was like, that's the best chorus you've ever written. And he's a big Fozzie fan. He loved the song Grail. Was a favorite of his. And when he came back and said, you know, I think I can really do something with this, let me try a few ideas. And I was like, dude, whatever you want to try, you go for it. If we like it, we use it. And so he sent back kind of a different arrangement of the song that really, really streamlined it and just captured a whole different vibe with it. And it's like, man, this is it. This is the one. So we really were, it was an honor to have him on it. But the fact that he actually took it and reconfigured it and made it his own was just an amazing, amazing piece of work from him to do something like that, just as a friend, but as a musician, too. He's not going to waste his time if he didn't like the song. So it was just a really cool collaboration for the two of us.
Right, and, you know, of course it's not going to hurt to have his name attached to the first single. It'll draw some much, much desired attention because the rest of the album just kicks ass, too. Right from the beginning, Spider in My Mouth just comes out and grabs a hold of you.
Yeah, it's funny because, you know, that was never a specific thing. Like, wow, you know, we'll have Shadows in the first single. It's just that when the songs were all done, and as you know, sometimes when you do a song, you don't really realize what it's going to be like until you get the final mix that's mastered. And when we heard that, it's like, well, that's definitely the first single. It's perfect. And Shadows, like you said, it definitely doesn't hurt to have it involved. But yeah, Spider is another song. It's a pretty cool, quote-unquote, problem to have, in that there's four or five songs that could go to radio on this record. That's a pretty cool thing. I think Spider is one of my favorites on the record. Sin and Bones is great, Inside My Head, Dark Passenger. I mean, there's so many cool tunes. But all we wanted to do is keep all the songs in the same vibe and in the same tone. Much like, you know, Metallica's Black Album, the record was genius in that every song fit. You know, there's not one song that, not that all the songs are the same, but they all fit a certain tone. They all fit a certain piece of the puzzle, and that's what we wanted to do with Sin and Bones. I think we've done that, in that every song, even though there's some different sounding songs, they all have a certain vibe and a certain color to them that makes it, like you said earlier, feel like a whole album. You know, this is an album that must be listened to from start to finish.
Right, yeah, there's a lot of cohesion on this record, and the sequencing on it, the choice of where to put the songs worked out really well, and a lot of people don't realize how important that is to an album to really make it flow properly. Now,
well, yeah, especially in this day and age when people download just the songs that they like, and that's fine. I mean, I don't have any problem with that, but still, I'm an album guy, and as long as there's one person on the planet who still appreciates a sequencing and a good record from start to finish, we're going to continue to do that.
I know on every album, every song has a story and everything, but there's some songs that have more intriguing stories than others. Are there one or two song stories from this album that really stand out for you?
Well, you're talking lyrically within the songs, or the creation of the songs?
How it came together, or the story behind it. It can be any of that.
Sure. Well, I mean, the last record we did a song called Wormwood, which is an epic song about the Book of Revelations and the Bible and that sort of thing. I just thought that was such an interesting thing to write about, and I've always loved long songs, so we did this 14-minute song called Wormwood that people really responded to. We got great reviews, and people loved it. And I wanted to do another long song on this record, and I had the title Storm the Beaches, and I always write songs based on the titles for whatever reason. And I just thought that would be a really cool subject to write about. It would be D-Day, and, you know, all the kind of stuff that happened with, you know, the D-Day invasion. So I found this letter online that a soldier had written to his mother. He had survived the D-Day invasion and had written to his mother, and kind of all the experiences that he'd been through. So I took that letter and just started working on that, putting it in the order, and going online and Googling different, finding what a potato masher is, and all these different World War II pieces of machinery, Higgins boats and, you know, AMRAAMs and stuff. So just started writing these really cool lyrics based on D-Day, and then that was kind of our epic of this record. I think it ended up clocking in at about 12 minutes, which was pretty cool. And another cool song is called Blood Happens, and I had that title, and Rich was writing a riff, and we were on tour. He was writing a riff in the back of the bus. He said, you know, all these lyrics that I have, I need something heavier. And I said, what do you think of the title Blood Happens? He said, I love it. He started working on the riff with his headphones on, so I couldn't hear him. I started writing the lyrics, so he couldn't see them, basically. And then when he was done, I was like, what do you got? And he played it for me. He's like, what do you got? And I sang it to him, and it's like, we had this perfect song in like 5 minutes that I had written the exact perfect verse and, you know, meter for what he had written verse-wise and lyrically and musically. So sometimes you just get lucky and you know, things all come together. But there's quite a lot of cool stories, because what happens is I write the lyrics and then pass them on to Rich, and then he takes whatever vibe that he feels from those lyrics and writes the music accordingly.
So, well, and again, this album, as we said, it's more of an album feel than just a bunch of songs put together that can be downloaded. You really have to have the whole thing. And one of the bands for me that always did that pretty well, and I think you're a pretty big fan too, is Kiss. And
For sure. I mean, yeah, I mean, there's certain, I think some of my favorite Kiss records, I'm one of the, I don't know if it's the few, but I think Kiss Revenge is my favorite Kiss record. And the sequencing in that is amazing, just how it's perfect and how, you know, it starts strong and ends strong. And I mean, Iron Maiden was like that. Metallica did that on some of their classic records. I mean, it's very, very important to put things in the right order and, you know, the flow of it. If this was a live show,
how would this work? Is it too many mid-tempo songs in a row? Is it too many fast songs in a row where it just turns into like a rave song where everything sounds the same?
Right.
So, I mean, when you care about it, you really got to put a lot of thought into it. I mean, Kiss was good at that. Actually, that's what screwed up the Elder, was that when it came to the States, the sequencing was out of order, and it's not the way that they wanted it, so the whole record was kind of screwed up because of that. So
yeah.
They actually have there's an Elder that has the original sequencing, which makes it a much better story and flows a lot better.
Right, and the reason I mentioned Kiss, aside from the fact that I know you're a big fan, you actually appeared on the Spin the Bottle All-Star Tribute to Kiss, you and Rich both, with Mike Inez and Fred Curry of Cinderella, doing King of the Nighttime World. Now, did you guys pick that
track? Yeah. Bob Kulick was the producer, and he always came up with certain ideas. He was the one, I think, that gave me that track. He also gave me the Evil That Men Do when he did an Iron Maiden tribute as well. So, yeah, I had fun working with Bob on a couple of those ones. But, the King of the Nighttime World turned out really good.
Yeah, he makes some great tribute albums like that. So now you guys are going to be taking Sin and Bone out on the Uproar tour all summer long with Godsmack, Shinedown, and Papa Roach and whatnot. That's going to be great for you. I mean, is this your guys' first full-on festival tour?
Yeah, it's pretty much our first full-on tour of the States. We've done a lot of shows, but most of them have been one-offs, so, you know, weekends here and there, but this is our first, you know, the Soup to Nuts, Pillar to Post, Coast to Coast tour, and we're really, really excited. We played about a week of shows last year in Uproar. We played Seven Dust, and they had some stuff they had to do, and that's kind of what gave us a taste for it. And I think that was maybe even almost a little bit of an audition process for us, for the promoters, John Oakes and John Reese, and when they were putting together Uproar this year, we wanted it, and we worked on it, we got it. So we're really, really excited, and I think we're going to fit in well with those bands. And, you know, our goal is to be the best band in the world and to steal the show every night. And I think we're going to open a lot of people's eyes that have never seen Fozzy live.
Absolutely, and I'm looking forward to seeing it when you come to my neck of the woods. And, of course, we'll sit down again and talk in person, hopefully with you and Rich. But I was going to ask you, because obviously what you do with wrestling is very physical and everything, but this being your first full-on lengthy tour, it'll be interesting to find out at the end of the tour what compares, taking the physicality and taking the toll on its body, the duration of a tour or getting prepared for wrestling every night.
We've done long tours, don't get me wrong, but they've just always been over in the UK and in Europe. And I'll tell you what, like, when you play overseas, It's sweatbox city, man. I mean, some nights clubs that you play in are pretty small, and other nights they're big, but there's never really a lot of air conditioning involved. So we put on a pretty high intensive energetic show. So you are covered in sweat night in and night out, completely drained. So yeah, there's a lot of similarities. I mean, it's pretty much the same physicality, maybe not as rough on stage, but it can be, you know, it's a cliche, but you definitely feel, you know, the strain of the neck when you've been headbanging and running and jumping and, all those little injuries that have accrued from 22 years of wrestling and 13 years of being a lead singer of Fozzy. They definitely come out when you've been on the road for a lengthy period of time, that's for sure. But, hey, it's all for rock and roll, man.
Absolutely. That's what it's about, the sweat and the blood. It's about the sandpaper, man. And speaking
exactly.
of which, you guys are going to be the tie-in there for you. You guys are going to be using that as the theme song for WWE SummerSlam pay-per-view event next month, I believe.
Yeah, it's cool. They used a couple of our songs before, Martyr No More from Grail, and then Enemy from All That Remains. And the thing I like about it is it's not like a favor. I mean, we have to submit it, and they, you know, go through the songs that they get, decide if they like it. So they chose Sandpaper for SummerSlam, so it's always cool. I don't really combine the two worlds very often,
right.
Especially when I was a bad guy. It's hard because people start going, you know, I could bring out my cute little grandmother, no chance, she's a crack whore. So you can't bring Fozzy out because they'll hate it because they think they're supposed to. And it's two different worlds. You know, when Jared Leto goes on tour with 30 Seconds from Mars,
right.
He doesn't go on stage and do, you know, Shakespearean soliloquies. He's there to be, you know, to be the lead singer of 30 Seconds. And that's what we do, man. So, but it's always cool that you get some love from the WWE with that song. And it's a great song. It'd be good for a people. It's got a lot of energy and a lot of fire behind it.
Yeah, I mean, it's an unusual circumstance, and you see it a lot where it's like if you're really famous for doing one thing, people really struggle to embrace or understand the concept that you could be really good at something else. It's like, no, he can't sing, he can't dance, he can't do this. He's a wrestler, you know? He can't be a singer because he's an actor, you know?
Yeah, exactly. And I think what you have to do is just continue to hammer home what you're doing and just prove to people that it's real. I mean, once people can smell bullshit a mile away, and they know when something is real and when it's not. And I think, you know, the fact that we've been around for 13 years, we've done, you know, 5 studio albums, a live record, we just keep coming and keep coming and keep coming. People are like, what the hell is going on with this? You know, I like to say the only people that don't like Fozzy are the ones that have never listened to us. And I've found that time and time again, that when people hear the band, they get it on Twitter all the time. They go, I finally checked out Fozzy. What was I waiting for? You guys are great. It's like, of course we are, man. I wouldn't do something half-assed. It's not some kind of thing. I just woke up one day and went, hey, I want to be the singer of a band. It's like, I've been singing in a band and playing bass in a band since I was 12. It's who I am as a person, as a performer, and I'll continue to do that. I don't give a shit if I'm playing, you know, in the Applebee's lounge, you know, laying down a couple tracks. I will play music for the rest of my life, and either you're in or you're out. That's the way I feel.
Absolutely. So before we get out of here, couple of quick questions, stuff that's going on these days. You were talking about being on stage and what it takes out of you or can take out of you and the physicality and everything. What's your take on this whole Randy Blythe situation?
It's hard, man, because, you know, the bottom line is, unfortunately, somebody died, and that's the worst thing. But, you know, I knew Dimebag, he was a buddy of mine, and the fact that he was, you know, shot and killed on stage, it changed the dynamic of having the guy come on stage for the fun, you know, headbang or whatever I used to see, you know, Ozzy videos in 1985. When someone comes on stage, it's cool, but when they stay too long, you start getting that warning, that radar. Because
right.
You don't know. I mean, that was proven already. You know, I don't know what happened. I didn't see it. And, you know, if Randy did, you know, push this guy or whatever. But the point is, I understand where he's coming from. And it could just as easily have been anybody who's a singer in a band where security doesn't do their job. You know, I mean, that shouldn't even be an issue anymore. If someone wants to climb on stage and jump off, they should get 2 or 3 seconds on stage, and that's it. You know, and then when you want to jump off and let the fun continue. But when you stay on there for too long, even if you're not going to do something violent, you might, you know, people want to grab the mic. Everybody wants to be a singer. Everybody wants to, you know, be a part of the show. And it's, you know, you just can't do that anymore. Times have changed. So I feel terrible for Randy. I would like to see him just come home to get a fair trial. And let's find out if he's even guilty before you sentence him to a month in prison or whatever the hell it is. But that's the problem when you play overseas. I mean, people, they make their own rules when you go to other places and other countries. And like I said, unfortunately, somebody passed away, but I would like to see him get home so then they can have some kind of a trial for him and find out if he really is guilty or not, and judge him accordingly.
Right. I mean, it's always terrible when there's a tragedy like that and there's a loss of life, but people want to look for deep pockets and somebody to blame, which brings me to the other big thing in the news, the tragedy of the Aurora shooting. We've already got the first guy trying to claim extreme trauma and sue everybody in sight. But, you know, I don't know if you have friends or family out in that area, but I think we can all relate to the tragedy that happened. What's your take on the whole thing?
Hey, once again, man, I mean, you know, you just hear something like that. There's so many terrible stories. I mean, we've all been to movies before, man. That's the bottom line. We, you know, it could have happened to any one of us. And how do you react? I mean, some people ran away. Some people stayed. Some people played dead. Some people, you know, it's like you just don't know how you're going to react to a situation like that. And, you know, that's the American way is sue. And who are you going to sue? You sue the movie theater because they let you in at midnight? I mean, I don't know. It's just like you said, when somebody passes away, when there's some kind of tragedy or something bad happens, everybody's always looking for excuses. And, you know, the bottom line is it was a horrible, horrible thing that happened, and I don't really know if there is no excuse. And I've been through it before in different ways, and you can sit there till the cows come home and try and figure out why it happened or what happened, but you sue until you want, but just be thankful that you weren't one of the people that was killed, you know? So it just makes it a crazy world that we live in. That's the sad thing.
Right. You were a friend to Dimebag, as you mentioned. I know you're friends with Zakk Wylde. They're talking, the rumors out there about a potential Pantera reunion with Zakk. What are your thoughts?
I'm not sure exactly what my thoughts are. I mean, I would love to see it, like, if it was done for the right reason. I think Zakk is the perfect guy and maybe the only guy that could actually replace Dime for a show or two because they were such good buddies and so close, and obviously the two guitar heroes from their generation. But, you know, it's not just that. I mean, there's so much more. I mean, obviously, between Vinny and Phil, I mean, those guys would have to hammer out a lot of things for this to even be a thought. And if they did, you know, hammer it out, and then they did decide to do, you know, a one-off tribute to Dime. I think Zach would be the perfect guy for it, you know, and I think it would be badass. I think it would be amazing, but it will never happen. Not because Dime isn't here, because Phil and Vinny, I think, just have this blood feud that might never go away. So that's the first thing that has to take place. But if it did, I think Zach would be the perfect choice to do a couple shows with them as a tribute to Dime.
Perfect. Last question then. Obviously, you're so involved in so many public things. Everybody knows so many aspects of you. But is there something about you that might surprise people to find out? Is there a side to you or a passion that you have that most people probably wouldn't know about?
I'm a huge One Direction fan, and someday I want to replace Liam and be the new member of One Direction. When I'm at home, I don't do anything. I try and shut everything off and just hang out with my kids, because when I'm on the road as much as I am, the only way that you can balance that is just when you're at home, do nothing but hang out with your family. So that's kind of something that I don't know people would expect, but that's definitely all that I do when I'm at home. I don't have any friends in my area, not in a bad way, but because I don't really go and do anything. I just hang out with my family, and that's the way it has to be.
So you're sort of a teddy bear at home then, is what you're telling us, then. It's all about the love
of course.
Family. Okay. So,
absolutely.
Awesome. Chris Jericho, of course, of Fozzy, WWE, and so many other things. Thanks so much for taking the time. The new album, Sin and Bone, freaking phenomenal. And, of course, you're going to be out on the Uproar Tour, so we're looking so forward to that. We just appreciate you taking a few minutes to bring us up to date on everything.
Thanks a lot, man. I appreciate it. Anytime.
Absolutely.
Take care,
brother.